I've been playing trombone since I was that tall. And back then, when I first started playing, it's hard to play when you can't reach those other positions, but I kept at it. And it just after 20 years of playing, I got to the point where I could play about anything I wanted to. And so I got asked to play in church.
Okay.
Get up here and say, I believe. And then he had to move on, and that was that. And that's not actually how worship has been done for centuries. The idea of everything built to the sermon, altar call, and done, that's comparatively new. The way we have worship set up, and we're following along what's in the hymnal, is based upon a set of travel logs from a 4th century nun named Egeria. She went to Jerusalem in the years 381 to 384, and she took very good notes on worship. And this is the point in time at which worship, they were putting together the worship, and you could, the number of years since Jesus was counted in generations, not centuries. And it's Jerusalem, right? This is where the church sort of put itself together, how it's been working. And so this nun named Egeria kept these notes, and so this response has the major part of worship, because that's what is what's most important. If we gather together, go us, and I say a few words, it'd be me, right? If you don't respond, I shouldn't have slept in. Right? If there's not a response, why are we here? We are here. That, you notice that's how we structure it, too. If everything builds to the big sermon at the end of worship, what's the highlight? What's most important? The preacher giving the big sermon. Is that what's most important here? No. What's far more important than anything I say is what you do. If you come late and you miss part of the sermon, so what? What's most important is what's to come. We're building towards the response when we respond to what God's word has proclaimed. Y'all are the important part. I just happen to have the mic for the first part, right? What I say sets up for what you do. And the first thing you do after the sermon, go ahead and open the bulletin and go ahead and look. What is the first word you say after the sermon? Seriously, open the bulletin. First word is right there. I believe. That is the right response. The very first response after me saying a few things is, I believe. This is baptismal, right? If you want to figure out how to baptize someone, I can tell you. It's here in your hymnal, but here's how it goes. I believe in God the Father Almighty. I believe in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord. And I believe in the Holy Spirit. Bless the water, get someone wet, baptism. That's it. That is the baptismal formula. And it is the first response. How do you respond to the Word of God, be a disciple of Jesus Christ? Yes, Jesus, I believe. That is our very first response. It's rooted in our baptisms. It's rooted in God. It says in 1 Peter 3, always be ready to make a defense to everyone, being graceful and truthful about what you believe. Not what you consider, not what you ponder, not what you think about. Be ready to defend what you believe. If someone asks, what do you believe? That's your answer. I believe in God the Father Almighty, in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit. So that's how we begin our response. What's next in the bulletin? Talk to me, folks. What's next? Good deal. Actually, am I reading that right? No, it's not. It's joys and concerns, right? The next thing is joys and concerns. We come to this time when we do two things that don't come easily because we're Midwesterners. We don't give an honest answer to an important question. And that question is, how are you doing? And if I ask, how are you doing, what are you going to say? You might have been to the baptism of a great-grandchild yesterday and seen joy and heard the laughter of a child. You could have been to a wedding yesterday and had your family gathered. You could have been outside all day and just enjoying the beauty of nature yesterday. And if I ask you today, how are you doing? You're going to say, fine. Right? You're not going to say, God is good and I am so blessed and I'm so thankful. So that's the joys. We get used to naming our joys. We're here, and this is a high point of my week. Right? I have a lot of struggles during the week, a lot of things I take care of. This particular week is going to be hard coming up here. You know what keeps me going? Right now. This is good. This is a joy. I'm so pleased to see you. How are you doing, Andy? I am blessed by you. We come to our moment of joys and concerns, we share our joys, and then we share our concerns. And that's also rooted in something that we don't talk about often. We've got to talk about our needs. Right? You could be struggling deeply, and if I ask you how you're doing, you're going to say,
It's a problem because I have had people walk into my office and they've been doing that Midwestern fine. To the point where by the time someone's ready to admit me, they walk in and they put a bill on my desk and say, Andy, I need help. And the bills hit four digits. And at four digits, folks, I can help with three digits. You hit four digits, and I'm renting you a U-Haul to move back in with your parents. Like, I can't deal with the four-digit problem. But that's what happens. We don't admit that we need help. And we practice every Sunday saying, naming our joys, and then saying, I need help. You need help? Does anyone here need help this week? I need help this week. Oh my word, I need help this week. Right? We need help. And to admit that, that's what we do. We have to get over our own sort of sense of self-reliance and practice confessing that the only way we get through anything is by God giving us our daily bread. Even the words we use to pray. What's the first word of the prayer we always use? What's the first word of the Lord's Prayer? You can't even pray without each other. You need each other to pray. It's not my Father. I can't even pray right without you. We've got to practice praying together to our Father. Then we get to confession. Man, those are high stakes. Because another thing we don't want to admit. How often who in here is in a hurry to admit when you're messed up? Right? This is the place we practice confession. Because what are we afraid of? If I show you, if I put in front of you how messed up and broken I am, what do you feel? That feeling in the pit of your stomach of intense embarrassment, like if you miss a high note you've been playing for years, right? But it's more than that. There's this fear that if I put myself in front of you and show you how broken I really am, that I have messed up, are you still going to love me? Are you going to come back next Sunday? Right? Are you still going to be my friend? Are you still going to be family? If I confess, like, where else can you practice being that honest and know that you're still going to be accepted and loved? Here's the place we practice saying these words that are horrible to say. I was wrong, right? You practice saying it here. Because when you get out there, you got to practice it. It's got to be able to roll off the tongue. You practice it here on the small thing. Anyone here have a perfect week? Okay, good. Everyone has something to confess. Did anyone murder someone this week? Good. No one has like a horrible soul destroying thing to confess. That means you have time to practice. You have time to practice confessing now so that, God forbid, if something does happen, you can do it. You're prepared. Because what you practiced here, you're ready to respond to your own failure, your own fault, and be able to know that you are accepted and welcomed and loved here, no matter what. Romans 8 writes, Paul writes, I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth will be able to separate us from the love of God. We confess, and then we know that we are accepted and loved no matter what we do. We can confess our sins and do it quickly. A crow doesn't get better with age. You might as well eat it fresh before it causes more damage. All right? Every Friday, there are two pastors I confess to, and I don't like it. But I might as well do it. Just do it. Confess. And you know, the thing about confession isn't specific. That's the other thing we like to do when it comes to confession. We like to be vague. How often have you heard that phrase, mistakes were made? Not even this, I made a mistake, but mistakes were made. That passive tense, so we can say, oh, someone else done. It's not mistakes were made. I whiffed. And here's how I whiffed. I got a bit too angry at my son because he did it again. We're potty training. I like it. Right? You walk in. And it's not, that sin is not vague. Sin is specific. It is right here. It is me sinning against this person. And to confess is to practice getting specific with that. Once we have confessed, the next response we have to God's word, Paul writes that we are entrusted with the ministry of reconciliation to be ambassadors of peace. And so we then make peace. We pass the peace. We create the peace. Hebrews 12 tells us that we are to restore the peace. Paul, if you Notice the refrain Paul has, peace and grace, grace and peace. At the beginning of his letters, grace and peace. At the end of his letters, peace be with you. Right? Peace, we follow the Prince of Peace. Peace is all woven throughout Jesus' life. And so this peace, this time that we create peace, peace which is not just the absence of conflict. If you can sit in the same room with someone and not punch them, that's not peace. Right? It's good. I appreciate that. But that's not the peace that we're talking about in Scripture. The peace we're talking about in Scripture is not being able to sit there and not punch each other. It's being able to enjoy a meal together. It's shalom. It's a peace that is rich in with lives that are woven together. And so we celebrate the peace that we are given, and we practice being at peace with each other during the passing of the peace. It's not the time to ask how much rain did you get. Right? It's not a time to ask how the grandkids are doing. It's a time to say, peace be with you, so that we can celebrate that peace that y'all are, that we are at peace with each other. And sometimes we're not at peace with each other. Sometimes we're at odds with each other. And this is the time to build that peace, because where else are you going to do it? If you're at odds with someone and you don't practice building peace here, you're going to do it anywhere out there. No, we do it here. And I've seen it happen. I have seen someone who had a grudge and had been holding that grudge since that person was 8, and now that person is something more like 80, and that person went up to the person that there was a grudge held against, and then they hugged for the first time in decades, and they made peace. I have watched two people, each representing communal organizations, like we have Old Threshers here at the Legion, like community organizations. I watched two people representing two community organizations who were at odds to each other over they were arguing who should pay a four-digit bill. Right? And they both had a very solid argument. They were angry at each other, these two communal organizations. And it was in the church that I watched the two leaders of those two organizations walk up and they shook hands. And I'll be darned if that next week they didn't finally figure it out. Right? We celebrate peace here, and then we create peace here. We practice it here. And if that means we hit flu season and every door you just get doused with hand sanitizer, fine. Right? It's what we need to do. We'll do it. And if you're sick, just sit. Don't get up. Right? But this is the place we practice and we create peace. Because if we practice it here, we'll be able to create it out there. This is how we set. So practice and create it. And then the final thing after the creating and the passing and the celebrating of the peace is the offering. Is there anything in your life that is not a gift? Somehow. Everything you have is rooted in the gifts that your parents gave you, the love that your family has for you, the teachers, the Sunday school teachers. Everything we have is gift. Everything we have, if it's good, it's because it's a gift from God. Everything that is good reflects God's nature. And so once we have been given such a gift, how can we respond but with such similar generosity? To take the first fruits. The Scripture talks about tithing and first fruits, and it talks about generosity and giving. And we'll talk about tithing another day. Today, just look at the first fruits idea. Now, this is the first day of the week, Sunday, and this is the morning of the first day. So here you are in the first hours of the week, giving your best hours to God to say, thank you. Right, that is how we give. We give generously. In a culture that tells us that there's not enough to go around, are you ever afraid there's not enough to go around? Anyone ever hear it, get worried? Right. This is the place we practice responding to that and saying, no, there is enough. God told us there will be enough. There's enough to go around. Even if 5,000 people show up at your door and all you have is two fish and some measly bread, there will be enough. There will be enough to go around. And we say thank you to God for that enough. But we sing, right? Praise God from all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. After Olivia and I said our vows to each other in front of the church in Bevere, Sacred Heart Catholic Church, we turned to the church, which was a little bit smaller than this. About 300 people were crammed into it, and we sang the doxology. We want to say thank you. Right? When you are surrounded by your friends and your family, to the impressed me because they'd given us so much. And it wasn't the stuff wrapped in paper. It was all that they'd given us to make our lives so rich and full. And to be with us on that day, how else can we respond with the same thank you? Right? We practice saying thank you for the abundance we have and to live out of that generosity. We practice it here in the middle of a culture that would tell us that there's not enough, and we say, no, there is, because God told us there is, and it is good. And then we move to communion, and communion is going to be next week. We're going to talk about communion and coming to the table, and so hold that thought. Worship is the time and the place that we practice our responses to the Word of God and to each other. And we practice it week in and week out, again and again and again. We don't practice it till we get it right. We practice it till we can't get it wrong. You hear the difference there? We don't here to practice being gracious and forgiving until we can get it right when it's easy, i.e. right here. We practice it here again and again and again until we can't get it wrong, so that when we go out there and someone cuts us off, we can forgive. When someone needs help, right? We practice here so we can get it right when we go out there. Thanks be to God.